Newsweek really pissed me off. They didn't write a story about my friend. He saved a reporter's life, saved the entire convoy, was the only one who was killed. And nobody heard about him. Nobody knew his name. So I started Black Fly. I started blogging really quite accidentally. I have a big mouth, I don't shut up, and when I'm not talking, I'm writing. I was reading a blog before I knew I was reading a blog for, I would say, probably a year.
It started because it was so difficult to stay in contact with family and email and phones. And a blog is sort of kind of a way that they could, you know, check on me and know that I was okay while I was in Iraq. And lo and behold, I get a bunch of readers, a bunch of people start emailing me, and then I felt like I had almost a responsibility to continue blogging.
I decided that I would start a blog to share that experience, what that experience was as a parent who had a son at war.
Well, I had a lot of mothers try to hook me up with their daughters. So, you know, that was interesting.
So it was kind of a two-pronged effort when I started the Soldiers for Second. One was to talk to somebody while not really talking to anybody. And to get out the true story of what we're doing in Iraq, which is the successes.
It's really one of the most important things is for vets when they come home to be able to tell their story, not to be silenced. They often don't, they feel people don't want to hear what they went through or that people aren't going to understand.
I go mainly initially as kind of a therapy. When I got back from Iraq, it was very difficult to talk to anybody really about the experiences that had happened in Iraq.
My son and myself remained completely and totally anonymous until he was wounded last August, when in a panic of, oh my gosh, my son has been wounded, I put his name up on the blog and then quickly took it down. But as you know, once it's on the internet, it's out there.
After the war started, it got out that I was doing this, and there was an investigation I found out later. Someone in my unit figured out who I was and reported up my chain of command to my commanding officer. He never mentioned it to me. I found out that he had done this, but I never mentioned it to me until the day that he was changed command, a year after we got back. And he called me into his office and said, Scott, hey, I just wanted to tell you that I really enjoyed reading your blog. So there was an investigation. I found out that I had to read every entry that you made, and you never once violated offset. And the way I did achieve that was I changed everybody's name. I never mentioned my unit, where we were, what our mission was. So it was really a vague web blog. But that also contributed, I think, to the success, because what that did was it made me kind of a generic military personality.
Back home, all the successes that we were doing along the way, my wife was only hearing the bad stuff about where I was and how I was in danger, and everyone was, we're having such a hard time, and we're bogged down, and we're never going to make it to Baghdad. And very rarely did you see all the people lining the streets. Literally, as we're fighting, people are underneath our weapons trying to shake our hands. And I think part of our responsibility today, for one, is to not be biased and just report the news as we, report our stories as we see them and as factual information and try to keep the spin to someone else.
There are good journalists out there, but and there are good newspapers and magazines out there, but we don't get to see the majority of those. And so I was getting emails and letters home, pictures that just contradicted everything I saw. And so I started putting that information up. And I thought a long time ago that if I had 300 hits a day, that'd be a success. And that's all I wanted to do.
And I started going and reading the MilBloggers and their accounts of what they're going through over in theater. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, what a contrast to what you're reading every day if you go to Newsweek, God bless them, or Time, or pick a paper website, watch a channel on television. And there was such a vast difference, and it was starting to really get me angry. And it just seemed like they were, what they achieved in Vietnam was just whitewashed. And when I did a little bit of scrounging, I figured out the whole time growing up, my understanding of the Tet Offensive was that we really got it handed to us. I mean, there was just too many of them. We just couldn't take it. And it turns out, doing a little bit of reading, we waxed them pretty good. But that wasn't what I heard from what, well, I didn't hear. I was, you know. But that isn't what I understood and what people understood, because what dictated how people understood Vietnam was Walter Cronkite reporting the Tet Offensive, and it's just bad news, and we're losing, and we got to get out of here. And you look back in history, and you look at how the media caused an entire country to trade in victory for defeat, please. Because they didn't. What milblogging means to me, and I'm not really, I'm only a milblogger because I'm a veteran. I sit up here on this panel, I'm like, I'm a boy among men. Who knows who I am and who really cares? But read Matt's People You Should Know. What I think that's probably one of the treasures of the entire internet. And what gets me is, why do we need to go to some place called BlackFi to find about it for the first and sometimes only times unless I'm of the milblogger links?
Here, here.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, one of the things that blogging does, people want to be heard. They want their story to be heard. They want people to recognize, hey, this is what I went through. What often happens, people leave a combat zone, they come home, they're placed back in society. You know, society hasn't changed, their job is the same there, you know, and they come back into this environment, and sometimes it's not even acknowledged that, hey, this person has spent the last year, the last 2 years overseas fighting in a very different environment.
When you start to realize that about 95% of people in this country get their view and their information about the war from local publications, you know, we all read the New York Times and the Los Angeles papers and Chicago papers, and we all know they're bent. The people in small town America are not reading those papers, they're reading their local paper. And this is a local paper from a community that is ultimately, as I say, very pro-military. And it has a large contingent. It's the front page from our paper, the Daily Courier, a couple of days ago. It's 15 pages, and in the 15 pages of what's supposed to be the most important news to me, there isn't one line, one story, one word about Iraq or Afghanistan. 150,000 plus of our men and women in harm's way at war, and this country is at war, there isn't one word. And then they wonder why there are no blogs and why we need the internet for additional sources of information.
I think they feel like they're being ignored. You know, they do feel like they're coming back, and it's not the same as with Vietnam, where they're actually being, you know, spit on and called baby killers. But it's also not like World War II, where they come back and there's the ticker tape parades either.
I don't think people look at the media the same way they did maybe 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. I think it's changing, and I think it's because the speed of information is changing, and it's outpacing the media, who are resistant, like everyone is resistant to change. I'm resistant to change. And what you've got is a media mechanism that is slower than the information, and we're outpacing them. And where milblogs, I think, come in as important is one key thing is that what happened with Walter Cronkite dictating a story about the Tet Offensive to an entire nation can never, ever, ever happen again. Not ever. Because of milblogs.
I work for U.S. Central Command, and I engage bloggers by providing them access to news and information so that the milbloggers can report accurate information that is occurring in Iraq, Afghanistan, and in the Horn of Africa. Well, my experience is, we've been doing this for about the last 9 months, is that when we provide news releases, stories to milbloggers and bloggers, they tend to be more accurate than what the mainstream media is reporting.
If the Army restricts bloggers, all you will have are pissed off dissident bloggers who are willing to take a risk.
Amen.
Article 15 Schlepp, it will be online blogging. And the guys that you see in this room who are trying to get the word out and tell the right stories will not.